young kids, we focused on children who had minimal verbal skills. So they were young children who didn't have really good, strong, functional communication. And we randomized the children so that the groups were essentially equivalent based on age and gender and also on the number of hours of ABA treatment, because from the research perspective, it's really important for us to understand whether this is more effective or less effective depending on how much kind of intensive treatment the kid is getting outside of our treatment study. Many of these kids were participating in other treatments, either at their schools or in their homes. We had two measures that I'll share with you today that were the primary measures, which were what we call the SLO, which is a structured laboratory observation, which basically, you'll see lots of video of this in a second, but basically the children come into our clinic and they interact with their parents and with the clinician there in the clinic, and we see how they're talking and how they're improving. And then we use something that's called the CGI, the Clinical Global Impressions Inventory, and this is a rating that's made by a blind clinician, so somebody who doesn't know whether the child participated in the PRT treatment or whether they participated in the psychoeducation group. And they ask the parent about whether the child has been improving, and they view videos of the child, and they watch, and they look at the measures that the parent is filling out. They look at sort of the whole picture, and they make a rating about how much the child is improving. So it's an objective, sort of separate, blind rating about improvement. And this is, there's a lot of problems with this scale, but this is really one of the key measures that's used in other randomized controlled trials. And so to be able to compare PRT to other empirically supported treatments is helpful for us to have this information. We also collect a lot of other information from families in terms of adaptive behaviors and other standardized measures of language. So we randomized the two groups. The children would come in, they'd be assigned to one of the two groups, and then they would participate in a 12-week trial that included 8 group sessions and 4 individual sessions. And I'll explain what that looked like in a second. So in the PRT group, really the group focused on teaching PRT. We had, in our group sessions, we showed them PowerPoint presentations about PRT, like you've seen today and yesterday. We showed them standardized video teaching examples, much like what you've seen today and yesterday. And we also had parents videotape themselves at home trying out the PRT, and we gave them feedback about how they were doing. We had specific goals that we were working on each week. We had them bring in videos, and we gave them feedback about trying to make their opportunities more clear, or trying to make sure they're using a natural reinforcer or reinforcing attempts, things like that. In the individual sessions, which happened every couple of weeks, we would really focus on individualized coaching, setting specific goals related to the child, and then providing individualized coaching. But we only did a little bit of this because we were providing a lot of feedback in the group sessions as well. And then, like I explained, in the psychoeducation group, all of the group and individual sessions were really focused on general topics related to autism and autism intervention, and there wasn't specific child-focused feedback. And then we collected data at both baseline and in week 6, and then at post-treatment in week 12 to see if there was an effect on the group treatment. This gives you a little bit of a sense of what the PRT group looked like, because many of you might be curious about that. So in the first 1 to 2 weeks, we had group sessions where they learned the basics of PRT, and then an individual session to set goals, and then another 2 group sessions where we would review parent-child videotapes, mostly focused on having parents set up really clear opportunities and provide contingent reinforcement, just that kind of A, B, C structure of behavioral learning trials. And then we would focus on, in individual session week 6, on having parents try to demonstrate using PRT to the clinician and to receive a little bit of feedback. And we would review videotapes in the 7th and 8th week and talk about shared control and maintenance and acquisition tasks, some of the other sort of finer tuning work in terms of the motivational principles. Another individual session in week 9, where by then we're expecting the parents are going to be able to show pretty decent implementation of PRT. We're just kind of tweaking around the edges a little bit, hopefully. And then in 10 and 11, we have the individual session. On week 12, we have the parents sort of demonstrate PRT to us. We're hoping by then that they've met fidelity, and we're giving them final feedback and ideas about where to go next. I want to say a little bit more. Oh. I've been logged out of the network here. Great. I want to say a little bit more about what some of the dependent variables are and then share some of the data with you. So in this structured laboratory observation that we collected, we had 10-minute probes where we had blind raters, so people who didn't know the child, didn't know the family, didn't know what treatment they'd been assigned to, didn't know whether when they were viewing the video, whether they were looking at a baseline video or a 6-week video or a week 12 video. So they really don't know what they're seeing when they're rating these videos. And then we had these raters score the probes to see for both the fidelity and also for child language. And we had reliability raters overlap on some of the coding. In terms of the parent fidelity of implementation, we used the definitions that are there in the literature. We had our blind observers score the PRT points, which were operationally defined. Many of you are familiar with some of this literature. And we also had them score how many of the children were making functional utterances. We also used definitions from the literature here. It was a frequency count of utterances during the parent-child portion of the structured lab that I'll share with you. And we also really collected data about the type of utterance, because we wanted to know, not only are the kids kind of talking more, but is the quality of what they're saying, is that progressing as well? So I'll show you some examples of this, but you can see that we wanted to know if the kids were imitating what other people were saying, if they were using other kinds of verbally prompted speech, like answering questions. Like if I asked a kid, which car do you want? And the kid said, the red car. That would be verbally prompted speech, but it's not directly imitative. And then we looked at non-verbally prompted speech, where parents are using more of a non-verbal or a time delay kind of a prompt. They're just maybe holding something up that the kid wants and then looking expectantly, like the eyebrows raised. you know the look. And then we also wanted to see if we're seeing any improvements